this session we are going to see about treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. To give an overview of what are we going to see in this session, we'll see about the definition of postpartum hemorrhage, what are the risk factors for postpartum hemorrhage, how to prevent postpartum hemorrhage, what are the causes of this disease, and how to treat as per each cause. So this is what we are going to see in this session. So let's first go into the definition of postpartum hemorrhage. Postpartum hemorrhage is defined as blood loss of more than 500 ml within 24 hours of delivery. If the blood loss happens after 24 hours to 6 weeks, it is called as late postpartum hemorrhage, or some people call it as secondary postpartum hemorrhage. Now let us see what are the risk factors for postpartum hemorrhage and how can we prevent this postpartum hemorrhage. Now most causes, if you look into the case of postpartum hemorrhage, do not have any underlying risk factors. Now three or four factors are considered as risk factors. The first is prolonged third stage of labor, multiple delivery, fetal macrosomia, prolonged distension of uterus can lead to atony, in that way fetal macrosomia, and previous history of postpartum hemorrhage or known risk factors for postpartum hemorrhage. Now what is the implication of this? People having risk factors of postpartum hemorrhage are advised to undergo their delivery in centers which have measures for resuscitation with blood transfusion. Right. Now let's see, having told what are the risk factors, let's see how to prevent postpartum hemorrhage. Now postpartum hemorrhage can be prevented by active management of third stage of labor. That is said to be important factor in preventing postpartum hemorrhage. Now what are the measures should be taken for the active management of third stage of labor? The first and the most important is prophylactic use of oxytocin. This is one of the important preventive measures for postpartum hemorrhage, and this can lead to around reduction in more than 50% of the risk. People with risk with postpartum hemorrhage can have 50% reduction in their risk. Now how much oxytocin? Oxytocin is the drug of choice as far as prophylactic management of postpartum hemorrhage goes. Oxytocin is usually given as intravenous infusion, 5 international units to be given as IV infusion. One important practical point which each of us should remember is that oxytocin should never be given as a rapid IV bolus or undiluted solution rapidly, should never be injected. If we inject, two things can happen. There will be rapid hypotension and the patient can also go in for arrhythmia. So these are the two important dangerous effects which can happen with the intravenous use of bolus rapid injection of oxytocin, and for these two reasons it should be avoided. So first, that's the most important measure as far as prophylaxis goes. The second measure as far as active management of third stage of labor goes is the cord clamping. So delayed cord clamping is advised. Now what is this delayed cord clamping? Early cord clamping is clamping the cord within 1 minute after the delivery. So this delay is with around 1 to 3 minutes after delivery is called as delayed cord clamping, and these two are advised as prophylactic measures for reduction of, for prevention of postpartum hemorrhage. Two more measures which are not recommended is what is called as controlled cord traction, CCT, controlled cord traction, and uterine massage or the funnel massage is not advised routinely now. These two measures are not advised routinely now. but these two are advice for prevention of postpartum hemorrhage. Right? So this is about prevention of postpartum hemorrhage. Right? Before we go on to the treatment of, so we have seen the prevention aspect. Now let us see what is the cause for postpartum hemorrhage and how to treat this postpartum hemorrhage. Now coming to the cause, it can be easily remembered by a simple mnemonic. The cause goes by 4 T's. The first T is tone. The second T is trauma. The third T is tissue. And the fourth T is thrombin. Now let's see one by one what is the cause for each T. Uterine atony. This is the most important and the most common cause as far as postpartum hemorrhage goes. It accounts for 70% of cases of postpartum hemorrhage. Trauma can include lacerations, hematoma, uterine rupture. This accounts for around 20%. Tissue, retained products of conception, invasive placenta, this accounts for around 9 to 10% or less than that. And the last, thrombin, that is coagulopathies. This accounts for 1% or less than 1% of the cases of postpartum hemorrhage. So as we can see, the most important cause as far as postpartum hemorrhage goes is uterine atony, which accounts for 70% of the cases of postpartum hemorrhage. Now let's go, having said what is the cause for postpartum hemorrhage, now let's go into what is the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. Before we go on to the treatment, there is a dictum for treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. The dictum is that postpartum hemorrhage is not a disease, it is a sign. So every measure should be taken to find out what is the cause and treat accordingly. Treatment also goes by what, according to the cause. So please remember the dictum that it is a sign and not a disease per se. Right. Now let's go into each cause and see what is the treatment. So the first cause, uterine atony. Now the initial resuscitative measures is common for any type, and let's see that first. Now the resuscitative measures include the IV fluids if the estimated blood loss is around 500 to 1 liters. If it is more than 1 liter or 1.5 liters, then we have to give blood transfusion. Please remember that many hospitals have a policy that blood transfusion is indicated for people less than a hemoglobin level of 7 grams. But in cases of postpartum hemorrhage or estimated blood loss is more than 1000 ml and there is evidence of ongoing blood loss, we need not wait for the investigation, the blood level, hemoglobin level to come. We can directly start blood transfusion. So IV fluids, blood transfusion are the important resuscitative measures. We can give oxygen, high flow oxygen, 10 liters to 15 liters per minute of high flow oxygen can be given. So these are the initial resuscitative measures which have to be taken. This is common for any type. Now let's go to the pharmacotherapy or the pharmacotherapeutic way of how to deal with postpartum hemorrhage, especially as far as uterine atony goes. Now the drug of choice for treatment of postpartum hemorrhage is also oxytocin. We have already seen that for prevention also it is the drug of choice. Now how much oxytocin should be given for treatment? We saw that in prophylaxis we give 5 international units as infusion. For treatment it is 10 to 40 international units. This dissolving 1 liter of infusion fluid, usually Ringer lactate or normal saline, and this should be infused. So what is the rate in which this is infused? At a rate of 250 ml per hour to how fast we can give 500 ml per 10 minutes. So according to the severity of the hemorrhage, we can tailor the speed at which we want to infuse oxytocin infusion. Now, once we start giving pharmacotherapy, what are the parameters which we have to monitor so that we can know the case is improving or not? If you look into the parameters which we need to monitor, first is the pulse rate. The second is the blood pressure. The third is oxygen saturation. The fourth is respiratory rate, and the fifth is urine output. These are the 5 parameters which we need to monitor so that the vital signs are improving or not, we can know. Right. So this is the first drug to be given. Right. Now, if the patient does not improve, so we give the administered oxytocin, we measure these things, there is no improvement. So what should we do? The second option is, there is another drug called ergometrine. So if oxytocin at the dose mentioned some time back is not giving any improvement, then we need to give ergometrine. 0.2 milligram intramuscularly. There's an important point to note. Before we administer ergometrine, we should make sure that there is no retained, the placenta is not retained or any other products of conception is not retained inside the uterus. Now let's see why is this instruction or why is this precaution important. How does the action of ergometrine differ from the action of oxytocin? Now if you look into oxytocin, this contracts, if you look into the fundus, it contracts the fundus of the uterus, and if you look into the lower segment of the os, it dilates. And if you look into the contractions produced, the nature of the contractions, they are rhythmic. So that's why this is the hormone involved in the progression of labor, because it compresses the fundus or contracts the fundus, relaxes the os so that the fetus is delivered outside and the contractions are rhythmic. Now let us see what happens with ergometrine. Again, this is also a uterotonic drug which causes contraction of uterus, but there is a difference. It contracts the fundus, yes, it contracts. Here, oxytocin dilates the os, but ergometrine again contracts it. If you look into the type of contraction produced, here it is rhythmic, here it is tetanic. So now here, even though both drugs can cause contraction of uterus, oxytocin is preferred for induction of labor because it facilitates that. Now can you see here, there is contraction of os. That's why it's a very important precautionary measure that before administering ergometrine, we have to make sure that there is no retained products of conception, placenta or other things are delivered, then only we should give ergometrine. So that's the basis of why we should check that and make sure it is, there is no retained products of consumption before administering it. This also gives an rationale or the basis why oxytocin can be used for induction of labor, whereas ergometrine cannot be used for induction of labor. Right. Now, what are the contraindications for use of ergometrine, and what should we be cautious about? Now, there are two contraindications for use of ergometrine. Ergometrine is an alpha agonist and a dopamine agonist. It increases or shoots up the blood pressure. So the first and the most important contraindication is hypertension. Patients with preeclampsia, also ergometrine should not be used. Right. Now, we saw that 2.2 milligram of intramuscular ergometrine can be given. The action lasts for around 25 to 30 or 40 minutes. We can go up to a maximum of 4 dose with ergometrine. Right. Now, we have given ergometrine, but still we have made sure that there is no retained products of consumption, but still the bleeding is not controlled. Now, if you have initially thought the cause is uterine atonia and you have given 2 uterotonics and there is no response, usually with 2 uterotonics most of the cases will respond. If it does not respond, again you need to check whether is there any other cause, say for example uterine rupture, or is there any tissue this thing, or is there a hematoma, and make sure that uterine atony is the only cause. You can feel the uterus, you will feel a soft and a boggy mass, showing that it has not contracted and uterine atony, and all other features are not present. If you make sure, you can go ahead to give a third drug called as the carboplatin. What is this carboplatin? Carboplatin is a 15 methyl prostaglandin F2 alpha. Now, how much to give? 250 micrograms or 0.25 milligrams. This is given intramuscularly. How much is the limit? You can give up to a maximum of 8 times, and you can monitor for every 15 minutes, and if there is no improvement, you can give up to a maximum of 8 times. So means what is the maximum dose will be 250 micrograms into 8, it will be 2 milligrams. This is the maximum dose of carboplatin. Again, two contraindications or one important contraindication which we should give. This is contraindicated in people with bronchial asthma. It can cause bronchospasm and it should not be used in bronchial asthma. You can use in patients with hypertension, but you need to be cautious. So in people having hypertension, again it can increase the blood pressure. It is not a contraindication for use, but you need to be cautious. So these are the three agents for the pharmacotherapeutic management of postpartum hemorrhage due to uterine atony, which is the commonest cause. Now, if we have done all these things and still the bleeding has not stopped, the patient is having ongoing this thing, what are the other measures which are there for treatment? Now we have two more modalities, the mechanical and surgical. Now, during the resuscitation itself, it's better if you put a catheter and empty the bladder. Bladder emptying promotes the contraction of uterus. Right. Now, what are the mechanical methods? If the patient has not responded to the pharmacotherapeutic management, then we need to go in for mechanical measures like intrauterine tamponade. This can be done with Foley catheter or Sengstakian Blackmore tube, or there is a special intrauterine balloon called as Bakri balloon. So these are some of the things which can be inflated, can be inserted, inflated, so that the tamponade builds up, which can reduce the pressure, they reduce the bleeding. So one is the mechanical meshes tamponade. Again, if you have not catheterized, bladder emptying should be done, catheterization of the bladder. This helps in the contraction and the assessment of the patient also, right? So about the mechanical this thing, still tamponade does not correct postpartum hemorrhage. The last resort for treatment of uterine atrophy is surgical. We have compression suturing called as B-link. Compression sutures can be done. We can ligate the uterine artery, ligation can be done surgically. We can angiographically embolize the vessel, so embolization can be done. And finally, if nothing works, the last resort will be hysterectomy. So these are the surgical methods which can be used if the mechanical methods like the balloon tamponade does not work. So this is about the treatment of uterine atrophy as a cause for postpartum hemorrhage, which is the most commonest cause also. Now let's see what are the other causes. The second T, first is stone, the second T is trauma. This accounts for nearly around 20% of cases. There can be laceration of the cervical laceration can be a cause, or it can be a vulvovaginal laceration. These are the two lacerations which can lead to continued bleeding. There can be hematoma. That can also be uterine rupture. Now, how to deal with this? If there is a laceration, again we need to see what is the tear or what is the laceration, and it needs to be sutured. If there is a rupture of uterus, again we can do a repair of the rupture. If it is very big or beyond repair, we need to do a hysterectomy. Hematoma, again we have to do a physical examination of the patient, and if there is a hematoma, especially more than 3 cm all, it needs to be removed manually. So this is what are the causes as far as trauma goes and how we have to manage. Now the third T is tissue. Again, retained products of conception or invasive placenta can happen. So how are we going to manage if tissue is the cause? Say for example, among the retained products of conception, retained placenta is the most commonest cause, and let's see how can we manage this. By definition, retained placenta is placenta which is not expelled within 30 minutes of the delivery is called as retained placenta. Again, we can do a manual removal by injecting 5 units oxytocin drip, and we can do a manual removal with our hand, or we can do a blunt dissection with the forceps, and then it can also be removed in that way. But if we are not able to remove, then we have to consider, sometimes we can give mild analgesics and then try removing also. Now if it cannot be removed, then we need to consider the possibility of the cause being invasive placenta. Again, this can be of 3 types depending upon the degree or the depth of invasion. It can be, there are 3 types. One is, the first one is placenta accreta. Why this is called accreta? Because here the placenta is adhered to the myometrium. That's why it's called as placenta accreta. The second type is placenta increta. So here it invades. So here this is the type which invades the myometrium. The third type is placenta secreta. Here it penetrates the myometrium into the serosa. So these are the three types of invasive placenta according to the degree of invasion. Now, how to treat this invasive placenta? Many people advise conservative management with methotrexate. And the definitive management is hysterectomy. One more practical point, as far as whenever we are going to do a manual removal of the retained placenta, we have to administer a single dose of antibiotic also for the prophylaxis of infection. That also should be either intravenous ampicillin or first generation cephalosporin can be used for the prophylaxis. So that's about tissue as a pass. Now the last T is what is called as thrombin. This is the least common cause as far as postpartum hemorrhage goes. The patient can have coagulopathies. He can also have sometimes what is called as Phelps syndrome. Hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes and low platelets, or it can be BIC. If coagulopathy is the cause, we would have known it previously. The treatment will be the clotting factors, administration of the clotting factors is the treatment for that. And if it is DIC, again we have to see whether it is in which form of it, and we have to again can infuse blood and clotting factors and see that. So this is the least common cause, and we can manage it by giving the required clotting factor which is deficient in that particular case. Common causes could be von Willebrand's disease or hemophilia, or the common cause for the fourth T, the thrombin, as far as postpartum hemorrhage goes. So that's the four different causes for postpartum hemorrhage and how we will manage individual causes. So now to summarize what have we seen in this session, postpartum hemorrhage is defined as loss of more than 500 ml of blood within the 24 hours of delivery. Prevention is by active management of third stage of labor with prophylactic use of oxytocin and delayed cord clamping. As far as cause goes, it is 4T, tone, trauma, tissue, thrombin. Uterine aneurysm being the commonest cause, account for around 70% of postpartum hemorrhage. The initial resuscitative measures are common with IV fluids, high flow oxygen and blood transfusion if there is more blood loss. The pharmacotherapeutic measures, oxytocin is the drug of choice, 10 to 40 international units given as IV infusion. The second line of drugs and the third line of drugs are ergometrine 0.2 mg and carboprost 250 micrograms can be given up to 8 times. If the pharmacotherapeutic measures fail, we need to go in for mechanical methods like intrauterine tamponade with Foley or Sensation, Blackmore catheter or the Bakri balloons. If this also fails, the last resort is surgical management. We have compression trousers, we have artery ligation, embolization, and finally hysterectomy as the resort. So that's about the tone. Secondly, about trauma, if there is uterine laceration, vulvovaginal lacerations or cervical lacerations or rupture, we have to repair the rupture or suture it and do the repair work. Or hysterectomy, if repair cannot be done for rupture, then again hysterectomy can be done. As far as tissue goes again. Manual removal of retained placenta should be done with analgesia, or it can be done with the tether also. And if it is invasive placenta is the cause, it's a very rare cause. If it is the cause, again conservative management with methotrexate, or the definitive management being hysterectomy. If thrombin is the cause, again it can be 1 milligram factor deficiency or hemophilia, the concerned deficiency factor, clotting factor should be transfused so that the deficiency is taken care of. So this is in whole as the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. And I will end with the dictum of the disease, saying that postpartum hemorrhage is not a disease. It is a sign, and we have to find out the cause and treat accordingly. That's all. Thank you very much. Bye.